This is Mr. Impact Wrestling himself, Moose, and you're listening to the Irish Whip.
Hookers? Hookers and coke?
Hookers and coke, man.
You're the only pro wrestler I know that wants to do this shit in the morning.
Yeti, you're a f***ing moron.
Put it this way, I think Sammy Callahan might as well just change his name to Invader 1.
I want to know why. Like, he can dodge any question. Like, I'll tell anyone that. You can tell me the f***, but I'm going to ask specific questions.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
WrestlingNewsSource.com. For all the rest of you yahoos who are out there dilly-dillying you little wankers, we're actually receiving real wrestling news.
This is
Brett screwed Brett.
Who are you to doubt El Dandy? Because this guy's a serious professional.
Brett screwed Brett.
Hold two! Arm bar!
Hey, get a nice shot of the brand new Mr. and Mrs. Hunter Hearst Helmsley.
I hate you. I hate you. I hate your hat. I hate your t-shirts. I hate your wristbands. I hate your shoes. I hate your music. I hate the C Nation. I hate everything that you stand for.
So does Rule.
Yeah, they do.
What's up to the IW Mafia? JP, I'm running solo this week. None of this hot shit we were doing last week. I'm just going to come out. We're going to talk about some wrestling. I actually watched some the past couple of weeks. And we're going to talk about the world and the shit that's going on right now. Fucking COVID-19, the coronavirus. How I think it's going to affect WrestleMania. I was going to try to do a little debate today on this with Josh, but he's got some issues going on and he can't be here, so you'll only get to hear my opinion, the correct opinion. And we'll get into that later on. Now, I saw some people online taking a crap on the pay-per-view, the Elimination Chamber, and I gotta say, like, I actually thought it was a really good match. I thought the women told a great story in there. Set up the WrestleMania match that I think everybody knew was going to happen. We also saw the tag team match where, if you want to see, I mean, they did some crazy shit, the high-flying stuff. Then you had the men's match that was just a really good match. And it was a good overall thing. It was one of those shows where you got a little bit of everything. And I don't know how people aren't happy with that. You literally had a little bit of everything. So maybe you didn't like a match. That's fine. That's normal. Every show should have something for everybody. So, you know, you'll have your high flyer. You'll have your heavyweights. You'll have your women. You'll have, you know, just a little bit of several different styles. If a show only has one style, I mean, you're not going to walk into a ice cream place that only serves chocolate ice cream, because chocolate might be your favorite, but guess what? On any given day, you might not want chocolate. You might want to get, you know, vanilla or cookie dough or any other flavor. So, there's that. So, people just got to learn to kind of bear with shit a little and just be a little more considerate and not just crap on the product. I mean, if you're crapping on the product, why are you watching? I did not catch AEW this week. I did, however, watch SmackDown in the empty arena at Full Sail University. They moved it from Detroit to there because of the coronavirus. I believe Monday Night Raw is going to be from there as well. It's different watching it with no audience. In my opinion, they all did a really good job, because as different as it is watching it with no audience, I'm sure it's even harder performing with zero audience, because you don't have anything to play off. You don't have the audience members to boo or to cheer or to just pop as you come out, any of that. And it's they kind of rely on that, and that becomes a part of the performance. So I think those guys all did a really good job. I really thought the Cena in the Bray Wyatt segment that closed it out was great. The one problem being no audience. So Cena, in his promo, came off like a heel. And Bray in his promo came off like a baby. If they have to do that again, I think by the time they get Cena back in front of a crowd, he might be a heel. And, I mean, I don't want to say they, because I don't think the WWE ever intends to turn Cena heel. But people online have been asking for that for years. And I think they might get it by accident. Is it a good thing? I don't know, to be honest. Because he sells so much damn merchandise. And they need someone. Like, they need someone that's going to push the product, push the merchandise. Like, I think he's granted the most wishes ever for the Make-A-Wish Foundation. So, I hope they can get them in front of a live audience soon. But, doing Raw the same way, I don't see too much of an issue. I actually love that, the way Miz and Morrison did their promo. They kind of did like a very indie promo, playing to the quote-unquote crowd as far as, you know, we can't believe this is happening here in Orlando, blah, 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 when there's no crowd to react to it. To me, that made it a little funny. But kept them bad, guys. Kept us hating them. And now, this is going to be kind of a quick episode, probably about a half hour today, guys. So just bear with me. We're going to be doing, we got some big stuff coming. I know we have the new Defy Champ coming on in the next couple of weeks. I've reached out to some of the biggest stars in the world. Again, you know, we have just a lot of things coming up. And I think around WrestleMania, so as we start to close out March, which is coming up right around the corner, I think we'll be able to reach out to some more people and get a few things coming. I know we will have, it won't be me or Josh or Joe, it'll be another representative, a friend of the show, if you will. We'll be down in Atlanta, and I do believe we'll have access at the Impact tapings. So we may have some stuff there from one of our correspondents. And it's just going to be cool. Now, I want to say big shout out to WrestlingNewsSource.com. They've stood by us since day one. Ben over there runs a great show. And actually, in my Facebook memories popped up a hashtag when I started out, or when me and Josh and Joe were starting this back up again, and it was hashtag WNS, we never stopped. Because me and Josh, even though we're on different sides, well, not different sides of the country, but pretty close, we talk constantly, and it almost always revolves around wrestling. So, I mean, you guys haven't heard it, but this has been something that's been ongoing for a long time, and it's just been such a cool ride the past couple of years being back. It's hits pieces we never thought, and we're so proud of it, and it's just cool that y'all want to listen to us. Now, I am going to take a quick break right now, and I'll be right back, and we're going to talk WrestleMania, how I think it's going to go, how I think it should play out, and just the way I think it's going to happen. And the way, it's kind of wishful thinking on my end, but I'll be right back. All right. What's up, JW Mafia? So, We got a couple of weeks coming up into WrestleMania. There's a few more Raws. I'm hoping we get an audience back in the meantime. But if we don't, and regardless of if we do, I think this is kind of the way that it should go down. Because, so, this COVID-19, this coronavirus, I don't buy into the hype of it. Like, I'm not afraid. I went out last night. Like, I'm living my life. But it is something on a global level that is quite different. So if you're in places where there's international people in a large amount, a large quantity of people from all over the world, from these different countries, Italy, China, spots like that, it's different, and you have to be careful. And that's the places that you should probably avoid, but if you have to be in them, you know, then you have to take the precautions. And I was, you know, don't touch anything like that, you know, because the shit lives in, they say it can live in like plastic and things like that for at least a half hour or so. So if you touch anything, you gotta like wash your hands instantly. Now, what does that mean for WrestleMania? WrestleMania is a global, I'll say it's a global phenomenon. It's the biggest show of in wrestling every single year. People come from all over the globe. I can tell you 11 years ago, WrestleMania 25. Me and Joe were down in Houston, went to WrestleMania. We did security for Booker T. He had an autograph signing for his charity event for the children. And me and Joe helped out and did security on that. And I can tell you at that, which wasn't a WrestleCon. Oh, it was. It was a wrestling convention. I think pre-WrestleCon days. And that there were people there from all over the world that we met. And it's not just the wrestlers. So, WrestleMania is just a huge global event. And I honestly, and this sucks, because so many independent promotions put out more money than they will probably make on a show. But it's such good exposure for them that they do it. And to move their whole gimmick down to Tampa for the weekend and put on a wrestling show in somewhere that's not their state, maybe the different side of the country, and they're going to lose that whole investment, because I think WrestleMania is going to happen, but I don't think it's going to happen in the Buccaneer Stadium. I think it's going to happen in Full Sail University in front of an empty crowd. Because they have to put WrestleMania on. They cannot postpone WrestleMania. So the people that have tickets, they'll probably offer refunds, or, you know, maybe if you bought a travel package to them, they'll offer you the travel package to SummerSlam in place of that. And instead of, you know, maybe they'll offer you tickets to SummerSlam in exchange for your tickets to WrestleMania. I had tickets to a concert in Kentucky, which I was going to fly out to see Metallica in September. Metallica backed out because of some of their issues. And so what the promoter did was said, I'll either refund you your money or you can go to one of the other shows that I'm running that Metallica is still a part of. And I think WrestleMania does something similar to that. And I think it's the right thing to do. I think going in front of the empty stadium, canceling fan access, what they can do to make up that is bring fan access up to Boston. Wishful thinking on my part for SummerSlam. Now, you can offer the people very similar travel packages for SummerSlam. They can come up to Boston in the summer. It's nice up here. You get it's one of the most historical cities in America, so, you know, kids could probably talk their parents into doing that, and it's somewhat educational at the same time. And, you know, you're taking SummerSlam. And there's tons of independent promotions up here, so there'll be a million shows that weekend to see. And that's how WWE can make up for it. And offer refunds or SummerSlam, Survivor Series, Royal Rumble next year tickets. Any of those are acceptable. And actually, so like if you wanted to say Survivor Series or the Royal Rumble, if you wanted those tickets instead, you could actually get the same ticket. And maybe they only give you a couple bucks back. Something along that lines. And I think that's kind of what they need to do. So now, yeah, I think WrestleMania, I think they can pull it off in front of the empty crowd. And still have great matches. And it keeps them sort of quarantined to a point because they're going to stay in Florida. They can stay right in Orlando and put on their show. And because, let's face it, so many of the people, like, you can't fly into America from most of the European countries right now. There's a travel ban. So there's that, too, where a lot of the people who bought tickets, one, it's going to be really easy for them to get airfare back right now. The airlines are giving credit back for travel because people aren't traveling because of this. And a lot of the people just can't get here. So it's sort of a win-win for them to do it in front of the in the empty stadium. Everybody can watch it on WWE Network. And I mean, what better way to get people to pay that $9.99 than to have it literally be the only way to watch WrestleMania? So now you get subscribers. It's really a win-win. And I think that's the way it's going to go. This coronavirus is crazy. And it's just, they have to be careful with it. And I don't believe the hype of the coronavirus, but where it's international, there's just a lot of things that can go wrong. And the WWE doesn't want to take those chances. So that's that. And I'm looking forward to the next couple of weeks. Like I said, we got some people coming on from Defy, who we've worked with for a long time. And, you know, we just had Schaff on the other day with Yeti. And Anthony Green, I think, will be coming back on. I'm holding off on something for him, but I may not be able to hold off any longer. I was trying to wait till I was actually in studio. But that just got delayed, actually, because of the coronavirus. So we'll get Anthony on. He just got back from a tour of Germany with WXW and, I believe, England. And I want to hear about that because it's not his first international trip, but it's his first huge international trip. Like, WXW is a big company. And, as always, just so proud of that kid. And it's just been it's cool for him. It's been insane to watch his career grow and to see how he does. And just so proud of him. And that's it. My buddy Kevin Quinn just celebrated his 30-year sober. Kevin, congratulations, brother. I'm so proud of you. That's Ref Quinn from Beyond and Chaotic and all over New England. He's done MLW. Another guy that I've seen literally since he was a fan in the audience, even though he's an old man. And just so proud of him. And I told him I wish I could share a beer with him, but one day we'll have to sit down and have a coffee. Kevin's just always been a good dude to me and always been a friend. And as always, Kevin, I'm proud of you. And you're doing such a good job on the independents. You're everywhere, and there's a reason for that, because you're one of the best referees out there. You're right up there with some of the guys that I know you look up to, and I know who they are. So, Kevin, keep up. AG, keep doing your thing. TIW Mafia, I'm sorry for the short week. Some personal issues this week, some stuff going on. But thank you, guys. Thank you for being loyal. Thank you for shooting our numbers way the fuck up again. We're on the rise again, and that just, it's so cool to see our numbers go up, and so cool to finally, like, be recognized for some stuff. Like I said, the things that are coming up, like having a studio that I can have guests come into, me and Josh will be able to go live and take your calls live on the air. So you'll be on the Irish Whip if you want to be. Stuff like that is just coming up, and it's right around the corner from where we're at right now. So thank you, guys. You know what I'm going to do is I'm going to plug in a little... a classic right behind this. I think I'm going to put on Original Sin and Outback Jack. Two guys that you don't hear from so much anymore. Kizarney, a.k.a. Original Sin, and Outback Jack will be coming right after this. Thank you, guys.
All right, welcome to the Irish Whip this week. I am Big Joy, and here with JP, and we got our first guest right off the bat with us. How you doing, Big Joe? We have the Original Sin. What up? How are you, buddy?
You doing all right?
I'm doing all right. I just worked out. Had me a big shake, so I'm going to try not to make any disgusting noises on while I'm here with you.
Hey, dude, we're not censored. Come on, let it go.
So, JP here, Sin, you go right ahead.
I'll prep some for you. Give me a break.
You got a burp. You got a fart ready, man. Just put it right up to the phone.
Hey, let it rip. You know, just like you were doing the electric chair with Carnival Diablo.
Right. You know what? I've never broke wind in the electric chair, but I think now that you just put that in my brain, I might have to bring that to the table next time around.
Right off the bat, real quick, we had a question coming at me and JP from the chat room from Gary Brown. He's one of our listeners over in England. He wants to know who our favorite wrestlers of all time are. And I'm gonna have to throw mine out there. I'm gonna have to go with the first one I remember watching back in the day would have to be Andre.
Andre, all right, okay. I would have to say I was in awe of Andre, but my favorites were Macho Man and Jake Roberts all the way.
That's a good. I mean, I had...
and at when I was a kid at recess, I was always Roddy Piper.
Gotta be the loudmouth.
I'm gonna take Piper for my favorite of all time, but the one that probably sticks in my head the most, and I'm probably gonna take a little bit of heat from this, is Hogan. So I'd say it'd be pretty close between Piper and Hogan.
Yeah, it's like with me going back, I remember, it's like, you know, it's like they always tell you, you always remember your first. The first person I ever remember seeing watching wrestling is Andre the Giant. Black and white, I was holding the rabbit ears to my grandfather's Andre, and it just stuck in my head forever. Then going through the years, of course, you have, you know, different eras, different decades, you have your different favorite. But at that time, it was Andre who sticks in my mind.
You know, when I was a kid, I got to see Andre live in my hometown of Toronto. It was at the big event where Steamboat and Jake worked, and they had the little dragon and the snake and what have you, and the machines and Paul Orndorff and whatnot. And I mean, there was an unprecedented amount of people, and you could look around like, where's Waldo? And you could find Andre every time. I mean, he just stuck out. So I mean, I can totally understand just how impressive he was, and I don't think it's an uncool thing to like Hulk Hogan. I think most wrestlers wouldn't be wrestling today if it wasn't for Hulk. So, you know, there you have it.
Like, every generation has their person who personifies the era.
Right.
And in the 80s, it was Hogan.
Well, I mean, he did things in a really smart way. I mean, you know, he wrestled. I mean, he was a big, huge superhero kind of guy, right? So, I mean, he didn't appeal to, you know, just to the next guy over. He always appealed to what people aspired to be. He was that superhero, you know.
Larger than
Superman, life. And, you know, that was it.
Just
that
like Sin, the anti-superhero.
Oh, you're very... Well, sure, I'll take that. Why not?
Now, you got a DVD out right now, Warrior One Wrestling.
Yes, sir. It was a show we did this summer up in Ontario. Had Mick Foley as a special ref in the main event against Raven versus Samoa Joe, and Samoa Joe had Jimmy Hart in his corner. It was a huge, huge show. It was something that we were all really proud of putting on in Canada. Sometimes Canada's sort of the polite version of what the Russian bloc was. it's sort of a land that's not, you know, it's separate from the States, but it's a cousin, but it's still, it's got its limits, and, you know, we're polite and clean and safe, but the U.S. just has so much more. You know, the U.S. is just that land of opportunity, and sometimes wrestlers as skilled or what have you as they can be, you know, Canadian, U.S., British, Japanese, whatever, sometimes just with the, you know, with laws and whatnot and, you know, visas and what have you, it makes, I guess, any non-American wrestler, you know, stuck in a sticky situation right off the get-go. So we wanted to do a show that would really put over Canadian talent and in turn, you know, just be a good show that anybody on the planet could see. I mean, people came to watch that show from Italy, from Turkey, from Australia. There was all sorts of people. There's tons of people from Britain. You know, just come like fans, just coming to watch the show. So we were just in awe. We just thought that was totally cool.
Something like that big, you'd throw it out on TV.
Well, I mean, what we wanted to do was, and when I say we, I mean myself, Scott Moore, Rob Flagel, who runs Squared Circle in Toronto, a handful of us that really put our brains together. We wanted to do a show that was basically an independent WrestleMania. We wanted to have the best of the best. We wanted to have skilled guys, you know, names, non-names, just the best guys we could have, the most hardworking guys we knew, and that's what we did. And we basically threw a party. That's what it was, really. You know, I invited all the guys that I really respected, or do respect, and we had a blast. It was a really fun show.
I mean, I'm looking at your MySpace, which people can get to from going to the original Sinn. That's the original Sinn with two N's .com, and that'll link it up to your MySpace account where you have the banner up there for the Warrior One Wrestling. There's not a name up there that I don't know. I mean, you say it's a lot of independent guys, but these independent guys are the top of the independents.
Well, I mean, independent is really just saying non-WWE, but I mean, a lot of those guys were former WWE, former WCW, New Japan, CMLL, ROH, TNA. There was a smorgasbord of dudes on that show, and they all really worked hard, and I thought it turned out to be a really great show, and I was really proud.
Yeah, you said being an independent, all that is without contract, you know?
Basically, independent is just kind of a, the word independent just sounds low budget, I think. I mean,
yeah.
Free agent is a much nicer way, I think, to say it, because that's what we are. I mean, you know, we get paid to go all over the world and entertain where we're getting paid to entertain. And, you know, guys, some of these guys are so savvy. They've been to just about every country you can think of. So, you know, I mean, they've all got skills, and they've got worldly skills. They're not, you know, they're not guys that just, you know, were hired and then trained. These were guys that busted their asses and went here, there, and wherever, you know, to get acclaim, experience, TV time, everything, building up fan base, you know, everything.
That's what it takes. And, I mean, they put in the legwork, and now it's paying off when they're getting put on all these major shows.
That's right.
It's like last week we had Petey Williams on, who was part of the show.
Yeah, yeah, we were actually in the ring together, Petey and Bobby Roode against myself and Helvis, who was basically... he was the newest member of the new church at the time. And basically, from that show on is where we officially branched out to be the tag team Beast of Burden. He's a really great guy. He was trained by Al Snow and D'Lo Brown. When I was first breaking in, he was one of the guys that was really instrumental in helping me out and showing me the ropes and what have you. And we actually tagged here, there, and wherever, just sporadically and coincidentally, long before Slash and I ever tagged. And... it's funny, we've never had a three-way tag, we've never done any six-man stuff. The closest we ever came was we all got drunk at Slash's house one night and passed out on his couch, and that's close to getting slashed in and Helvis in the ring at the same time, but knock on wood, and we'll see what's up in the future.
I think that could happen. That would be a nice match. See you three going against Team Canada.
I think since Slash and Helvis, I think that would basically be, you know, a demolition for the new era. And I definitely think we would kick Team Canada's ass.
Do you think they can handle think the ring can handle that much demonic power?
I'll make sure to fireproof the ring before we let our infernal...
make sure your Scotch guys get all the blood out, too.
Yeah,
we're going to have
to add
hell to the World Cup.
What's that?
We're going to have to add hell to the World Cup tournament.
The World X Cup, they had... You know, the land down under, Satan's world, will have to bring their own their team up there with the three of you.
That's right. That's right. And actually, too, just my brain jumps for like Phoebe from Friends, so I'm all over the place. So this is what happens when you get jacked in an electric chair and get darts thrown at you for a living.
I gotta see that. When is that gonna come down to the States?
I don't know. They've got a lot of shows planned for Canada, and they've got shows I think planning for England. They're planning to do a loop of the island there. That's all in the works. I don't know. I would love to do a show in the States. I think it would totally freak out everybody. They've seen a taste of it when we did the dart stunt with Jim Mitchell and whatnot at TNA. But they've never seen the full blown show, and there's some crazy stuff that goes on that show. I mean, it's nuts.
Now, I've checked on the website right now is the Carnival Diablo for people out there that don't know. How much pain can one man take now? What's the most painful thing that you've done there?
The most painful thing is the, well, obviously it's the electric chair, but I'll tell you a funny side story that one time we were doing, let me just put this in the words here. We're doing a show called Mind Trip for a Discovery Channel that we filmed just before Christmas.
Right.
And we were going to do the electric chair and a few other things. And we did the electric chair, and the deal was on this Mind Trip was a few different performers. There was like a psychic, and there were some paranormal guys and whatnot, and then a couple of the Diablo crew. And the whole thing was supposed to be done in front of a panel of scientists so they could, you know, speculate and hypothesize and whatnot. So usually when I do the electric chair, I'm usually, you know, in my ridiculous fur pants and my leather boots and all that stuff. And I wanted to have the scientists have not a doubt in their mind that it's legit, because, I mean, there is amperage coursing through your veins that can kill a horse. And I wanted people to know this. I wanted those scientists to know it. So what I did was I just walked out bare feet in just basically a pair of little black undies and made sure, like, there was no room for any speculation. And when I get jacked in that chair, it's basically you just kind of go to that weird place and you just get kind of that white light of pain. I can't even describe it, but it's not anything where you focus on aggression. You focus on serenity. Like, it just, you kind of, you know, the pain's coming, and you just sort of buckle down and get to that weird safe place, and you just give her. And so what happened was I was in my bare feet, and I just took my feet off the ground, not even thinking about it, because, you know, I wear these big, ridiculous black boots and stuff, so my feet are always touching the ground, and I'm sitting there like a little kid with my feet kind of dangling in between the chair, not even, you know, thinking about it. And I got jacked in that chair a handful of times trying to light the torch off of my tongue, which was sort of like a little tiny arc of lightning comes off my tongue, and I light this torch. And it wasn't taking, and the more we tried it, like, I've never tried it more than twice without, you know, really having a headache and smelling like burnt Eggos for the next 3 days. But I couldn't figure out what was going on, and it just started making me angry because, you know, usually I'm doing this with calmness, and this time I'm starting to get, you know, aggressive because, like, my ego is kicking in. And finally I realized, wait a second, I'm not even putting my feet on the ground. I put my feet on the ground, and we lit the thing, and the camera crew just about had a heart attack because the director just thought I was going to die, which, I don't know, who knows? I'm just, I guess, too stupid to lay down and die, but that's my sort of side note of Mind Trip.
Now, I read in your bio on your old website there that both your parents were black belts.
Yeah.
And did they kick you in the head a little bit too hard?
They kicked the shit out of me all the time.
What would possess you to get into a friggin' electric chair?
You know what? It pays better than slaving away for 9 hours a day at Mickey D's. God bless people who can do it. We need them, and they're stronger than I am. I would definitely rather take a large dose of pain fast than a slow dose of boredom. You know, it's like prison. I would go insane. Those people are way stronger than I am. Real people in the real world, definitely stronger than me or any other wrestler, I guarantee.
That's just some crazy shit.
Yeah, yes.
And willingly.
Well, I mean, it's kind of fun in some disgustingly sick kind of way because, I mean, just, it's the same thing as being in the wrestling ring. You know, you're getting, you know, a whole auditorium of people booing you or yelling for your blood or whatnot. It's kind of a fun rush.
Oh, it's like the adrenaline gets pumping. Whether they cheer you or boo you, you know that they're focusing at you. All their energy is focused at you, and it's pumping you up, and you must feel less pain than if they weren't.
It's pretty weird. I mean, it's a cool weird, but it's not normal.
I don't think so. All right, I got another question for you coming
yes,
in.
Sir.
This is coming off of our website from a person who calls himself the wrestling expert, and
okay.
I'll read this whole little blurb there. Is there any chance that you return to TNA either with Slash or some other former member disciples of the New Church? You kind of got to this a little bit. Or possibly get together with the Monster Abyss now that he's managed by the Sinister Minister?
All right. Well, I don't have any problems with Abyss. I don't have any problems with Jim Mitchell. Jim Mitchell and I are very good friends. As far as seeing Nick Simple and Slash back in the TNA ring, cross your fingers. Might happen, might not happen. In the wrestling world, you just don't know until you see it. I'd be cool with tagging with Abyss. I think that would make a pretty good creepy family. I definitely think AMW, and I think Diamonds in the Rough from Team Canada and Naturals. I mean, they better start running if they see Slash, Sin, and Abyss together, because that's scary even to me.
I mean, you got Showtime running scared now because Sting might be coming back. I mean, you got Sin and Abyss coming after him. I'd be running too.
I'm gonna tip you off a little backstage stuff as far as Showtime. He likes to be called Big Earn. Big effin' Earn. Just so every fan out there knows, that's his name.
Big effin' Earn.
Big effin' Earn. And he should be running scared of Sting because, why not?
Yeah. All right. Now, I think, with the sinful character would fit in, and maybe not, I don't think right now at The Undertaker, but back in the day before the ministry, when he was coming out, that would be a perfect mix. And now I think the sinful character would blend perfectly as the overpowering factor of the boogeyman in the WWE.
Oh, don't even get me started about the boogeyman. All right. Undertaker, he is definitely one of, he was definitely an inspiration, and he is one of my favorite wrestlers. The boogeyman, well, I don't know. I don't know. Whatever floats your boat, I guess.
Well, I'm just saying, I can see, your character being, the all-powerful demon, you know what I'm saying? And then having the boogeyman be your little lackey, your little henchman
your
bidding.
The thing is that I'm all about, entertaining, and, my favorite thing is to freak out the kids. I mean, getting adults to boo and cheer, whether I'm, a good guy or a bad guy, whatever's going on, that's fine. That's fun and part of the job. But I'm a kindergarten cop at heart. I'm a birthday clown at heart. I love to, get the kids either booing or cheering or, whatever my job is that night. And that is my ultra favorite. But at the same time, as hokey as that can get and as silly as the character can get, I'm a legit carnival freak. That's what I do. I'm not playing some silly character. I'm not, some boogeyman that's under the bed or in the closet or whatnot. I'm a legit carnival guy. I'm not from hell. I'm from Toronto, Canada. But I'm a legit masochist. I'm a legit pain guy. I dig pain. It's not a problem to me. I'm not weird. I'm quite a friendly, polite, happy-go-lucky dude. But pain to me is not a big deal. And I like it. And that's probably one of the reasons why I'm a pro wrestler. Because, just like Christian said the other night, I can take a great ass kicking and come back for more.
It's like that tattoo on your back, that must have hurt like a son of a bitch.
That hurt like a mother,
one of those.
Yeah. And what got me through it was I bit down on my knuckles and stared at a poster of that tall blonde chick from Nashville Pussy. She got me through all 12 hours of my tattoo.
That's a big tattoo.
Yes, sir. Yeah, they told me that it would hurt lower down by my kidneys and not so much up by my muscle, but for some reason that whole effing thing killed like a bastard. And I mean, I can take some pain, but it was droning and droning and droning. Like, when you get a little tattoo somewhere and it sort of numbs out after the first minute. Well, this was all long line strokes because of the feathers and whatnot, so it was basically like the first minute times 12 hours, which really did suck.
If anybody wants to check that out, they can go to the original Sin at sinwith2ends.com and check out that that'll link you to his MySpace. It's myspace.com/theoriginalsin. And you can check out that tattoo. It's of like black feathered angel wings on his whole back. It's a sweet-ass tattoo.
Yeah, real nice. I want to take a question from the chat room. And this question made
doing research on you, kind of a pain for us, Sin. What's up with this other Canadian using the name Sin as well? Like, how does that, neither one of his copyright is? And do you, have you ever met the guy?
I don't have the name copyright. I know who you're talking about. I actually did a, I never met the guy, but I've heard about him. Actually, I did a clinic in Montreal a little while ago, basically being Lance Storm's stunt dummy, basically. And that's who he thought he was coming out there to throw around to teach the students. And he was, I guess he was pleasantly surprised that it wasn't that Sin. I don't know enough about this. I don't know anything about this guy. So I keep on hearing, oh, yeah, there's another guy named Sin. There's another one in England, too, I think, even though I spent a whole ton of time in England and never met that dude there either. But, you know, whatever. I mean, Sin is a universal word. It's just an acronym. So whoever wants to use it, they can use it. But there is only one original Sin.
That's what it goes down to. Who does it better? The original Sin is the first one out there.
That's right. I don't see that guy in Winnipeg with some crazy wings on his back. I don't see that dude in England with some, you know, darts hanging out of him or electric chair underneath his ass.
I say, if they want to have an argument over who can hold the name, whoever can sit in the chair the longest wins.
Amen.
And I'm just saying that, I want to stand up right now. I'm not even in an electric chair.
No. You know what? I'll tell you something funny about that damn chair. One time, I was just sort of just shuffling to get comfortable, and when Creepy Scott there, his stage name is Nikolai Diablo, he hit that switch just a millisecond faster than I was anticipating, and I shuffled over, and I lifted my ass off of that seat for, it couldn't have been a quarter of an inch, and that chair just grilled my ass. I had a black, sort of a black mark on my ass the size of a grilled cheese sandwich after that for about a week. I will never, ever fidget in that damn chair again.
Now, you say you had the black mark in your ass. Have you ever missed? Has that, like, the shock ever missed and got you where you shouldn't, where no electric shock should ever hit you?
Well, like I said, the closest painful place I ever got was in the ass. So if you're listening right there and you just heard half of that sentence, I'm not even going to go into that.
Well, JP takes in the ass, so.
Fair enough.
He takes electric shock. He'll take, you know, someone's boot. He's a walk-in storage cabinet right there.
I understand.
Now, you've also, if I'm going to bring this up, you've also written some comic books.
Mm-hmm.
And,
yeah, that's actually what paid to put me through wrestling school way back in the day. Ever since I was a kid, I always drew and did, like, freelance artwork and whatnot, and eventually I did a comic book called Fred the Possessed Flower, which was just some silly little kind of a horror comedy about a flower, Fred, who was in charge of all the corporate marketing for hell. And, you know, underneath him he had Boogeyman and Tooth Fairy and Easter Bunny and Santa and all that stuff, and Satan was basically just like the dumb boss that just owned it while Fred did all the legwork and whatnot. And I did a bunch of comics, and then I eventually did like a big full graphic novel. And my brother and I, we wrote a novel after that. Like no pop up pictures, no nothing. It was just a straight novel.
Comics for the kids, this novel for the adults.
Yep, basically. So don't judge a creepy book by its cover, even though I am, you know, some weird pain-indulgent masochist, I can string a few words together, and I can doodle. So there you have it.
Now, what?
There's no pop-up, so Joe won't be reading that one.
Yeah, I don't read anything without pop-ups.
Pop-ups are dirty.
No, but that's all Joe can read. That's right on his level. So.
I like scratch and sniff, too.
Now, you're in the wrestling world right now, so be very careful with that.
Now, both the comic books and novels, can people still pick those up somewhere?
Yep, they can get them on theoriginalsin.com.
All right, and they can also pick up the DVD for the Warrior One Wrestling, which they can also see at warrioronewrestling.com.
Yep, they can go to either or. It's warrioronewrestling.com, and it's the number one. And yeah, you can get it. You can send in money orders, or you can do the PayPal thing. You can see a trailer on the website. It's pretty cool. I mean, it's the guys that edited everything did a really great job. There's a lot of funny stuff. When I produced the DVD, the double DVD rather, I really wanted to make sure we went very MTV with it. Like, I wanted people that weren't even wrestling fans to be entertained by that DVD. So if you're a wrestling fan, obviously you're going to enjoy the matches because there's some of the best in the world on that DVD. But, I mean, you know, the commentary in between, there's some... I sort of wanted to piece it together like the old school Coliseum videos where you'd have, you know, like Sean Mooney and Johnny V throwing to the next match and whatnot, and sort of adding in some little comedy shtick and some personality in between everything. And our host was JT Playa, who is he was a promoter in Ontario and Niagara Falls for Neo Spirit back in the day, and now he is a freelance wrestler, and he's basically sort of the second coming of Sweet Daddy Siki with a whole level of Richard Pryor to him. So he's as funny as you can imagine. And him and Jennifer Blake, who is this cute little blonde girl who totally looks lost next to Player, but it's funny as heck. And they announce every match, and it's really good. And there's a lot of bloopers and outtakes and all sorts of stuff that the fans can see, like all the backstage stuff. It's really good. It's done very well.
Looking at the band now, and you say Kamala goes bowling. That's something I want to see, wrestling fan or not. I want to see Kamala bowling.
Well, when I was putting together the show, like I said, I didn't want to think, you know, I mean, a lot of the startup wrestling shows, they think very linear, and, you know, they could be so much better. There are so many good, talented guys and girls that are wrestlers, you know, that can put on a heck of a show, but it needs to be promoted and needs to be advertised, God forbid, like a, you know, a real product. Like, there's nothing wrong with wrestling. It just needs to be promoted correctly. You know, Mr. McMahon's made $1 billion off of this business, you know. So, anyway, my philosophy behind doing my own show was I didn't just go... I mean, I made sure all the wrestling websites and so forth, you know, had info on Warrior One, but I sent it to, you know, radio stations and TV stations and newspapers and what have you. And I looked for as much advertising and as much PR as I could because I knew that these guys had the skills that... If the mass people could see it, you know, the wrestling fans and the non-wrestling fans, they'd be entertained. And I really wanted to think outside of the box. And I thought, well, Kamala at a bowling alley, I mean, that's as MTV as you can get. That's as surreal life as you can get. Like, that's just as good as Vince Neil and MC Hammer and Webster eating sushi off of some naked stripper. You know, or at least well, that's as close to my budget as I could do it, getting Kamala in a bowling alley, which was totally funny.
If you get a question coming out of the chat room, I think.
Yeah, from Fan Mark. He wants to know what you thought of your time on the Maritime Tour.
The Maritime Tours. Okay. If you ask, again, Showtime, Big Earn. If you ask Helvis. If you ask Big Petey Kingman. Anybody that was on that tour, JT Playa, they will all tell you that was probably the most fun time in their entire lives. We had a blast terrorizing the Maritimes. We got to work, you know, we just looped the entire Maritimes going from Nova Scotia to New Brunswick and so forth, all over every town you can imagine. We hit it and we tore it up. And those guys were great, talented guys. A lot of guys that people just don't know about. Like, something that I think a lot of the diehard wrestling fans don't realize is just because you haven't heard of some guys doesn't mean that they're not skilled or entertaining or whatnot. You think only the guys that you've seen on TV, you know, that's got to be the end-all, be-all of wrestling. There's a whole universe of other guys that are great wrestlers that just maybe haven't got a break or haven't shown their wares at the right place at the right time or whatnot. But there's some awesome wrestlers. Let me just think. 6'10" Kingman. You know, this guy is basically Kane size. You know, he can cut a promo like Triple H, and he's the size of Kane. I mean, if that's not money, I don't know what is. And he's a hard-working guy. He knows the business. He just he works mostly overseas, and he's really unknown even in Canada, outside of the Maritimes, and he's unknown in the U.S., but he's a great talent. He's also on the Warrior One DVD, a close friend of mine who we met in the Maritimes, and he came out to lend his support to the show, and he's a really great worker. People would enjoy watching him terrorize the heck out of whoever he's in the ring with.
Sounds awesome. I'm going to have to pick that DVD up.
Well, all right, if you want to get it, WarriorOneWrestling.com, brother.
I'll be there, WarriorOneWrestling.com, The Original Sin with Two N's.com. You can check it out. You can pick up his novel. You can pick up his comic books, and you can pick up the DVD. Check it out. We'll be right back at the Irish Whip with Big Joe and JP. I believe Sin might be hanging around with us. We'll be right back.
Business Advances Web Hosting. With plans as low as $2.95 per month, you can get the professional web hosting solution that you need.
Visit www.businessadvances.com.
A total hosting solution at a fraction of the price.
Register today and we'll give you 100 free templates to get you started and even more freebies.
www.businessadvances.com. Simply business as usual.
The Voice of Wrestling with Chris Cash and Big Mike.
Lex, I know how hard it may be, obviously, and of course, now that you have come forward, as you have mentioned a couple of times, we weren't there. Everybody listening was not there. There was two people there that night, to my knowledge, unless you say otherwise. One more time, can you at least take us through that night, as hard as it may be, of what took place?
I thought you dozed off again. It was 4:05 in the morning, you know, so I'm thinking, I go, baby, eat your stuff, you know, it's warm, and she didn't respond. I said, Liz, you know, and I got a little strong with my voice, and she didn't respond, so I walked over to her, took the thing away. That's when I first noticed she didn't seem right, and sorry.
The Voice of Wrestling with Chris Cash and Big Mike, live every Monday from 7 to 9 Eastern, leading into Raw. We are the true voice in professional wrestling.
We're back. This is JP. I'm here with Big Joe.
We still got Sin sitting in with us, and we have another guest coming on.
We've got Outback Jack.
Outback Jack, he was the man when I was a kid.
He still is.
Damn good.
Oh, chaps, you've caught me at a little bit of a loss. I'm not terribly prepared for this conversation.
What were you getting your number off of Tim Beale? He had said he was going to set this up for us tonight.
Wow. Now you must have forgot to tell me.
I apologize for that. If you're not free, if you want to drop off, we completely understand.
I mean, maybe it's better to do tomorrow night, if that's suitable to you.
Shoot. We won't be on.
We're off and running, so let's keep going.
Okay, right. I apologize for that. Want to talk a little bit. You're doing the BaleCon 06, March 25th.
Yes, that's correct.
And it was Tim that hooked us up with you, so we want to talk a little bit about that, of course, and what you'll be doing with them.
Yeah.
We, of course, want to talk a little about your WWF career.
Sure.
I apologize again for catching you off guard.
I was just in the middle of watching Law and Order.
Well, I hope you got TiVo then.
Yeah, well, no. Unfortunately, I haven't even thought about that.
Now,
where are you fellas broadcasting from?
We're both from Boston.
Hmm.
And we've got our other guest that's on with us now. We have the original Sin. He's up in Ontario.
How you doing, sir? Nice to meet you.
Good day there.
He's here now. He came in. He had made a quick pit stop from hell. He's going to make sure he get the first ride back. That's it.
I was on another show earlier tonight. I tell him the best place that I ever thought that I ever wrestled for hardcore stuff was Boston Garden, the old Boston Garden.
Really? It was always a good show.
Yeah, it was pretty nuts back then when it was the Garden. I mean,
yeah,
there was
exactly
as many fights in the stands as there were in the ring.
Yep.
Oh, sometimes the fights in the stands were more entertaining.
It was. I remember one time I was working with Nikolai Volkov, and he told me to duck, and I ducked, and a beer bottle bounced out of the middle of the ring and actually hit Nikolai just a little bit below the belt and doubled him over, but didn't hit me in the head. So that was funny.
That was probably my father who threw it.
All right. So you broadcast throughout Boston area?
We're in Boston. We're on the internet. We go worldwide on the internet.
Hmm, cool. You had some questions to ask me.
Yeah, we were going to talk about, like, what will you be doing with BaleCon? Is it, you know, signing autographs, that type of thing?
Yeah, that's all. I'm too old and out of shape to get in the ring.
Now, when you were in the ring, how'd you get your start there?
Oh, I just happened to be in the right place at the right time in Australia in a pub in Humpty Doo, Northern Territory, and the
WWF was doing a world tour, and they were in Australia, and we happened to meet up one morning on a Saturday. We were going to wrestle in Darwin, and they walked into the pub while we were all having beers, and it was like watching fellas come to life off the satellite television. That's where we used to watch them, you know.
Oh, wow.
I've been down to Australia. I was down there when I was in the service, and Australians are legendary drinkers. Now, Andre the Giant was a legendary drinker.
Yes,
where would you compare to him?
Andre used to drink wine. I used to drink beer. I guess the days went by, I could easily drink a case of cans.
That's a lot of beer.
Andre used to drink. He used to drink wine quite abundantly.
Drink it by the orchard.
Which service, Prince of the service, were you in?
I was in the Navy.
Ah, cool.
I spent a couple weeks down there. I hit Brisbane, I hit Perth. I had a good time. This wish I can remember most of it.
There you are. True believers like that, isn't it?
Oh, and I get the pictures, though. I don't know how. I get the pictures that came out with me, but the memory's not there. You know, little Fozzie, those Foster's oil cans can do some damage.
Yes, Foster's oil cans can. If you managed to get to Darwin, you'd have drunk a couple of Darwin stubbies. That would have rocked your boat.
I sat down at the bar and I had these the Australian woman, the Sheilas, coming up to me, and oh my God, they were buying me drinks, and it's like they had hollow legs. They just never got drunk.
Yes, yes. And then they told you, lay down, I think I love you.
Now, when you tell them the WWE, who was your favorite? Who was your favorite opponent?
Who did I work against? Well, I really enjoyed working against King Kong Bundy. He was sizable and you know, he knew his stuff. He was good to work with. Never missed a spot. Timing was perfect.
But he still, I've seen some tapes of him over the past, you know, recent years, and he still doesn't seem to miss any of the spots or anything. So
he's the consummate professional, without a doubt.
Australia. How did you wind up over here?
I was working on a cattle station. They came into the pub and that's how it all happened. And they invited me over after I took them out to a cattle station. And the cattle station I was working on, Arnold Skolin, was an agent that was with the fellas. I guess Hillbilly Jim and Junkyard Dog and the Hammer Valentine and Brutus the Barber Beefcake came into the pub and wanted to see what a real life Australian Outback pub was like. So,
and you showed them the ropes. So yeah, I'm looking at your bio and Obsessed with Wrestling. It shows here that you had a match with Rick Rude and
that's true.
In December of 87, and he made you submit.
Isn't that if I remember that right, he threw me over his shoulder in that crucifix, is it?
Yeah.
That was in a TV match in Fort Myers. I wasn't real impressed with that, but hey, sometimes you got to do what you got to do.
Yeah. Exactly.
I mean, it had to be something, moving from Australia, you know, coming over here and just becoming a pro wrestler, being, you know, wrestling in front of Madison Square Garden, the Boston Garden.
It was a lifestyle change, that is for sure.
Big culture shock.
Yep, completely.
What have you done after your wrestling career? Like, did you still, after your WWF career, did you stay in wrestling?
No, I stopped wrestling in about 1990, and I went into the financial markets. I worked in Lehman Brothers in Boston for a bunch of years.
Oh, wow. Right here, huh?
Yeah, right there, yeah.
Now, I got a question coming in from my chat room for you. Outback, it's coming from Professor VNS. His question is, where and when did you wrestle your first match?
The first match I wrestled in North America, I wrestled in Canada a little bit, of course, because I got to the United States and was sent over to Calgary, where I was trained by Les Thornton, the man of 1,000 holes, and traveled around in Stu Hart's territory out there, and through Calgary, Manitoba, Toronto, all of Canada. And so that would probably be the first match. Would have been in Edmonton. And whoever, I can't remember who I wrestled, but in the U.S., the first match I had was against Steve Lombardi in good grief, over in St. Petersburg or something like that, in over in Tampa. It was a TV match. And of course I won.
Now, like, you had a fairly short tenure in the WWE, but that short tenure transcended into a 20-year career.
Basically, yeah. You know, I was with them for on and off about 4 years there.
Now, what would you prefer, taking a splash by Bundy or working a cattle ranch again?
I'd prefer to own the cattle ranch. but taking a splash from Bundy, that was about as tough as taking an elbow from flying elbow from what's his name? Good grief! Now I've had an Alzheimer's moment. Randy Savage,
Macho Man.
But, yeah.
You see, I'd rather take the splash and have to, you know, work with some cows and stuff. Just doesn't seem like it'd be a whole lot of fun.
Cattle stations are interesting. You know, the beasts, you know, on the cattle station weigh about the same as Bundy, so it's really six or one, half a dozen the other, isn't it?
Well, who smelt worse?
Like, who smelt worse? Well, that's also a toss-up.
Are you a wrestling fan now?
I watch it from time to time. It's a little tough to watch. I mean, when I was back in '86, I believe was the modern heyday, for want of a better term. You know, I mean, I used to watch it when I was a young kid. You know, good grief, I remember Luthers, Red Bastine, Roy Heffernan, and Lou Costello with the Kangaroos from Australia. They were big names. They were world tag champions. With NWA was at the top of the sign. But the WWF, when I was there in '86, and we did WrestleMania 3 and so on and so forth. That's the modern heyday. And nowadays, the wrestling's fabulous. The moves they do and their athleticism is just spectacular.
Yeah.
The risks, the moves are so high risk. It's staggering.
Yeah, there's a lot of high-flying now. It's a lot less, you know, back then it was kind of all the big guys, and they kind of strayed off of that a little bit for the smaller guys that can do the, you know, all the flips and everything else in the ring that I can't even dream of doing.
Well, some fellas could do it. Like Tom McGee was a chap that came in for a little while. He could do a black flip off his just standing barefoot. I mean, he was incredible, but... I guess the other thing was fairly clear back then was the villains and the heroes were fairly defined and easy. There was an easy line drawn in the sand of who was who, and it's very tough to see who's got an agenda and who doesn't now, you know.
We got a couple of questions coming in for you from the chat room again. This one's coming from Gary Brown. He's over in England. He wants to know, what do you consider to be a greatest match and or opponent?
Greatest match. Personal favorites. I had a match one time with the Mighty Hercules. And we were in Hershey, Pennsylvania. And we had to get 40, 45 minutes. That was just an absolute rip snorter of a match. It was
a long match, even for today.
That one is one of my favorites. Is probably the top of the matches. And then, of course, there are a couple of Royal Rumbles on telly that I had that I enjoyed. But that one would be another one I had that I really enjoyed was at the good grief, over in the Meadowlands with the King Harley race. I did 25 minutes with Harley Race. That was because he was an all time legend, and that was just brilliant in my mind.
Another question coming in real quick for you is from Woody. He's over in Ireland, and he wants to know, can you still go in the ring? And part two is, when was your last match? Your last match, and who was it with?
My last match was with Greg the Hammer Valentine, and that was in Orlando, Florida, I believe, around 1990. And I haven't been in the ring for 16 years.
Any aspects of possibly signing one of the WWE Legends contracts and getting back in the ring, making some appearances for them?
No, I don't believe that Vince and I are the best of friends anymore.
Uh-oh. You want to elaborate a little bit, or?
No.
Okay.
Got a question coming in now from the chat room from Professor VNS. Did you get a
chance to engage in any high-profile feuds? And if you did, who was it with?
Yeah, I did have a fairly high-profile feud with Killer Khan for a long time, and that was mainly to set up hope for WrestleMania 4. That was a good thing. I mean, although Killer Khan was as dumb as a box of rocks and weighed about as much, too. He and I and Fuji went round and round for quite a long time.
Did you get hit with the mist?
Yeah, I did, actually. I did. And the stupid bugger, this was in Landover, Maryland. He was supposed to get out of the way as I was coming back. I was off the top rope, and he rolled underneath me, and I hit my head on his knee, the back of my head on his knee, and I detached the retina, 280-degree retinal tear on my right eye. So that my right eye is pretty much cactus now.
Yeah, that sounds painful.
A bit of a headache at the time, but it wasn't until later on when somebody shot a flashlight in there that I realized that I was in a spot of bother. And the fact that I can't see out of it now also is a bit of a clue.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's, that mist, like, you know, people don't realize when they're doing that, you're putting something in someone else's eye no matter what it is, so.
Well, sure.
Repercussions, you know. I want to just go back to I want to make sure we plug the Bail Con.
Absolutely.
At the Holiday Inn, 1800 Belmont Ave in Baltimore, Maryland, from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m.
I'll be there from 11 to 7, pending, of course, toilet breaks.
There's some other names there that are humongous. I mean, yourself, of course, you know, Captain Lou Albano, New Jack. Kamala,
the Valiant
Miller. So I mean, to anyone in the Baltimore area, man, it's $10 admission. You'd be nuts not to check this out if you're a wrestling fan or
absolutely.
Film stars as well. So,
for sure.
Just a fan of nostalgia in itself, and you know, anybody of a legend status in any type of field, you know, that's where you want to go.
Well, look, it's one thing to sit back and admire a person that's been your fan for yonks, and if you meet the cover charge and come in for $10 and sit down and have a chat and answer ask questions of your longtime heroes, then why not do it?
Right. It's a great opportunity.
You get up and close. It's not like you're watching them on TV or, you know, standing behind the barrier. You get right up there, you know, shake hands and, you know, get your picture signed.
Yep,
it's you know, that's something people, you know, bring their kids to see. You know, this is the guy I grew up watching.
Yep,
you know, it's a whole, it's like a rite of passing. I remember my father bringing me to places like that around here up in Boston when somebody would come up here for an appearance. They would bring me and say, "Oh, this is who I, you know, being a kid, I don't want to go see him. I don't know who he is, but you know, when he tells you, this is who I grew up watching. This is who, you know, who I used to look up. I was a fan of his when I was your age, and that's what, you know, that's what's going to make your legacy live on and on."
Absolutely, it makes perfect sense, and you know, it's almost silly as the same as to run a baseball analogy. It's like, you know, a dad taking his son to a baseball match for the first time, baseball game for the first time, and going into, you know, Fenway Park, and you know, knowing that I watched Carl Yastrzemski run the bases and you know, all the others.
Do you do a lot of these, like the autograph signings?
This is the very, very first one.
Wow.
Very, very first one. So, again, make sure you get to the Holiday Inn, everybody, because this is my first one. And, you know, if it's quite successful, maybe you'll get another. So you might get just a one-time exclusive autograph from Outback Jack and all the other chaps there. I think Bundy's going to be there. Jimmy and Johnny Valiant are going to be there. And, as you said, Kamala.
That was
going to be quite the collection.
Who's who of wrestling legends?
The person who put me in touch with Tim was Brad, who runs ObsessedWithWrestling.com, and he told me the only way he was giving me Tim's contact info was if we got you on the show, which, unbeknownst to you until about 20 minutes ago, we did.
Well, it's an honor having you on. I know you don't do very many interviews, if you do any at all, and you, I know you like to lead a private life,
But this, I lead a very private life. I haven't done anything. Wrestling hadn't raised its ugly head to me. I did a Where Are They Now thing for the WWF magazine back in, I guess, good grief, was it June last year?
That's the first
time it, June or July, that was the first time it had come out. And then, lo and behold, a radio interview earlier tonight, and then this one tonight. So, it's a shock to the system.
If I remember correctly, I think it says you work in the stock market or something to that effect.
Yeah, exotic options and futures and contracts on foreign currency, foreign exchange.
Oh, for a second, did they say you were an exotic dancer?
No.
That's a fan base for a whole different,
Yeah, that's
genre.
Something you want to talk to Freud about, not me.
That's too up close and personal, right?
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
You want to bring the fans in, not scare them away, is that what you're saying?
Something like that, yeah. Although there's probably, I do give good phone, so there's probably a lady or two out there that wants to be charmed by the dulcet tones of Outback Jack. I could be talking to that.
Take it for a trip down under.
Yeah. I think about being down. I'm not for sure.
Another question coming in for you from the Professor VNS out of the chat room. He wants to know that you were billed as Outback Jack in up in Stu Hart's Stampede. And he wants to know, where did the Outback Jack name came from, other than, you know, being from Australia and all?
Well, I was always called Jack. I used to hang out with my dad's brother, Uncle Jack, who was, I spent a bunch of years with him, so I was called Little Jack. And then when they bumped into me over in the Humpty Doo pub, and Vince brought me over, he said, "We're going to call you Outback Jack." So that's the birth of Outback Jack.
And how many names Vince has given people over the years?
Well, he has a fertile imagination, doesn't he?
Yeah, I guess Santa said earlier, he made him $1 billion.
Made him $1 million, for sure, for sure. Oh.
What was that, JP?
No, you said you don't really go back to the wrestling, but do you still get recognized in that type of thing?
Oh, no, not at all. Mate, I'm old and gray now. I'm, 48 years of age, I've got gray hair, and I wear a black patch on my elbow. People, occasionally a shooter asks me about the black patch so I can tell them a nice big lie to get into their panties. That's about it,
Yeah. Now, at BeelCon, you'll be wearing, the trademark leather vest and all that, right?
No, unfortunately, the leather vest and dearly beloved Irving they've disappeared into the dust. But I do have some relics that you'll be able to recognize Outback Jack. There'll be no missing him.
So you're basically saying some collector has that up on his shelf somewhere?
Oh, no, not at all. No, when I say Irving returned to dust, I mean, he's dust.
Oh.
He's gone for good. I'll have my leather dry as a bone on and a nice old very summarized Australian bush hat.
The gator tooth necklace?
No, the crocodile necklace, I was doing a European tour and I went into the ring, I was wrestling Volkov and Nikolai Volkov, and Stone the Crows, if I give it to the person that carries the gear all the way back to the dressing room and everything got back there, my hat, my vest, but the old crocodile necklace went missing.
Uh-oh.
So I haven't had that thing for a long, long time.
That's on somebody's shelf.
Yeah, that's on somebody. Or dangling around some shoeless panties.
So it's not going in the panties. That might hurt.
Of course. Well, somebody might be inventive enough to put a piece of wire through it and pierce their belly button with it,
Hey, pierce more than belly button.
Jewelry.
The amount of teeth on that thing.
That's it.
All right, so it's BeelCon. That's going to be March 25th. What's the address again, JP?
1800 something or other.
1800 Baltimore?
That's in Baltimore.
Holiday Inn in Baltimore. I don't have the address right in front of me, but it's March 25th, and it's 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. And, some of the biggest names in wrestling history, Outback Jack, The Valiant, Captain Lou, King Kong Bundy. I think when I talked to Tim, he told me the Iron Sheik. So, I mean, anyone who's an old-school wrestling fan, a fan from the 80s, the kayfabe era,
be there.
For $10, man, you can't beat that.
Can't beat that with the stick, yeah.
Cool.
All right, so I guess we'll wrap it up right now. Outback Jack, thank you very much for this honor of having you on the rarest of interviews that you do. This is a great. Again, we apologize for catching you off guard.
The honor's all mine. Thank you for remembering me.
How can you forget? How can we forget?
All right, chaps, thank you very much.
All right, thank you very much, everyone. Outback Jack, make sure you check him out.
Apologize for the short notice on that.
All right. Okay, guys. Thank you. Goodbye.
All right, this is the Irish Whip with Big Joe and JP. We'll catch you next week when we have a very, very big show planned. JP, you want to let the news out?
Well, I mean, I know we got, you know, Captain Lou Albano, but I think he's bringing someone with him, Joe.
Someone or someone?
There might be a few people with him. Jimmy and Johnny. I know Jimmy's been on the show before. We're looking at Captain Lou with the Valiants on the show, and this, as far as I know, is the first time the three of them have done an interview together.
We're going to have them all tied up together, three of them all at the same time for the hour. It's going to be a trip.
And
up on the train ride, just
Jack,
sit back
I'll make sure that these guys all know about this beforehand.
Yeah, we'll have to definitely clear that up, make sure that that's, you know, we don't want to run into it. Outback was a stand-up guy for not hanging up in your face, but, you know,
yeah. Hey,
worked out pretty good.
Nice guy, hell of a guy.
Oh, yeah.
And a legend, so.
Oh, and so make sure you check us out next week when we have Captain Lou and Jimmy and Johnny Valiant on the show.
Have a good week, everybody.
All right, everyone, take it easy. This is the Irish Whip. We'll see you next Tuesday.